Gracious Father, as we open your word, open our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, have you realized that COVID-19 has been a great leveler? It has taught us that all human beings are equal, irrespective of your color, your gender, your race, or your status. Prince Charles is suspected of coronavirus. It affected the royalty. Our own Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, is affected by it. And even our Health Secretary is affected by it. And we know, by the news, we know that some of the great famous sports stars, film stars, and other celebrities are also affected by it. Not only them, the common people like you and me also it has affected. So it is a great lever. It has brought all classes of people under one level to realize that we are all humans and we are all on the same page. I hope this concept will help us to understand each other better and be there for each other. But one of the biggest questions that people are asking, you might be receiving too many messages, WhatsApp messages and other social media messages. One of the biggest question, and people are curious to know the answer and are asking, is who is responsible for COVID-19? Who is responsible? And I'm sure you have been bombarded with so many messages saying, who is it? Who is it? How did it come about? What is it going to do? My sermon title is, who is responsible for COVID-19? And is it God or man or something else? You know something? Man takes credit for all the good that happens and blames God every time that something goes wrong or a tragedy takes place. Have you realized this? It is always God who is responsible when things go bad, but when things are all good, it is always our hard work. I think that's not fair. I believe there are five entities who could be responsible, who could be held responsible for these natural disasters or plagues or the virus that we are talking about, COVID-19. Who could be these five entities? Number one, God. Number two, Satan. Number three, man himself. Number four, animals. Number five, nature. Now the question is, who is responsible for this? Is all of them, or one of them, or few of them? Let's quickly look at each of them and see how we can come to some conclusion as to who could be held responsible. Well, as I said, whenever tragedy takes place, whenever some sickness takes place, whenever there is mass deaths, it is always God to be blamed. That's how. But let's see God in the first place. When you talk of God, you need to ask two questions. Number one, does God have the power to send plagues, pestilences, natural disasters, and viruses? You should ask that question. Doesn't that question look so stupid? Because it's obvious, isn't it? But it is necessary to ask so that we have a better understanding. And the answer is yes, of course. He's got the power to send these things. We read in Genesis 12:17, but the Lord plagued Pharaoh and his house with great plagues because of Sarah, Abraham's wife. So we know God can send plagues. And we know the 10 plagues, the great 10 plagues in Egypt, God did send them. And we know in Ezekiel 5:17, he says, I will send famine and wild beasts against you, and they will rob you of your children. Pestilences and blood shall pass through you. I will bring this word upon you. I am the Lord, I have spoken. What does it mean? God has the power to send disease, plagues, pestilence. So, can God do it? Yes, he can do it. The second question is, if God has the power to do it, Is it God who sent COVID-19? That's the question. Now, before we could answer this question fairly, we must also find out what the other four entities are capable of doing. Then we can compare and see how did it come about and who could be held responsible. So we'll answer this question later. Is it God that sent it? Now, the second entity who could be held responsible is Satan. Now, the question is, does Satan have the power to cause natural disasters, plagues, pestilences, and even the virus? What do you think is the answer? Has he got the power? The answer is, yes, of course, he got the power. I believe Satan works in three major ways to bring sickness and suffering onto people. Number one, Satan can cause sickness directly. It is obvious, you know, in the demonization. For example, approximately it is believed that 25% of Jesus' healings recorded in the Gospel of Mark involve demon possession. The direct influence of the devil is explicitly demonstrated when Jesus healed a crippled woman and was scolded by a synagogue leader for doing it so on the Sabbath. Jesus said, "Ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham," this is in Luke 13:16. What did he say? "Ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan had bound." Think of it. For how long? For 18 years, the devil have bound this woman with the demon possession. And then Jesus comes and loses or frees her. Satan's direct role also you can see in the life of Job. All the trouble, the sickness, the death, the plague, everything that he experienced in himself and in his children's lives and in his property is a direct association with what the devil has done. So one way that he could cause is directly. The second way is indirectly. Satan indirectly uses the natural result of the fall to cause sickness and suffering. Because of sin, this world has fallen into sin, and as a result, there's so many things that God never intended to happen are happening. So the devil can use the natural results of sin or fall of man to his own advantage in causing sickness and suffering. He can use bacteria, virus, malnutrition, accidents, fights, poison, old age, rapists, murderers, and on. In all probability, most sicknesses are a result of this kind of fall of man. The third way the devil can cause sickness is he tempts God's people to fall into sin. And when they fall into sin, it invokes God to punish them for what their sins are. You know, that kind of, when we fall into sin, for the wages of sin is death, and sinners have to be punished. So his duty is to put us to sin and then invoke the punishment from God on those who sinned. Now, there are so many experiences of this kind of sickness and death. At times, God used sickness to punish his people when they disobeyed and sinned against him. When the Israelites rebelled against Moses and Aaron, God sent a plague and killed 14,700. Then God killed another 50,000 Israelites at Beth Shemeth when they disobeyed him by looking into the ark of the Lord. And other experiences where, because of sin and its results, man has experienced sickness and death all around him. So no matter what the immediate cause, the unusual outcome of sickness are pain, suffering, and death. All that works for devil. He can cause it. He can cause it. So the question, does the devil have the power to cause sickness? Yes, he has. But the question is he responsible for COVID-19? Is it the devil that is responsible? As I said again, before we come to the conclusion, let's wait and see the other entities and see who actually is responsible. The third one, who do you think it is? We spoke about God, he's got power. We spoke about devil, he's got power. The third is man. The question is, does man have the power to create natural disasters, diseases? And in this case, COVID-19. Has he got the power? Can he do it? What do you think is the answer? The answer is yes. Let's not underestimate the power of man. He can do it. But the question is how? How did he get these powers? You know, when man disturbs the natural functioning of the creation, most of the things that man does on this earth is for his own selfish reasons of pleasure and abundance. So for his own, he has disturbed the natural flow and function of this nature that is supposed to keep the earth safe and intact. We have done so much damage to this earth, like deforestation, emission of poisonous gases into the atmosphere, contaminating of sea and its life. Now the massive buildings and the concrete roads and the creation of harmful material like atomic bombs that we created. Can you imagine what these bombs have done to human life? They not only killed, they are a source of breeding of so many diseases. Look at the incidents like Hiroshima and Nagasaki and Holocaust and other experiences, even when the World War II, what this bombing have done to human life. And the aftermaths are sometimes more severe than the act itself. So, and again, radiations, what that have done to the natural order of human life. So man, to enjoy his pleasures and to make his life as how intended to be, used nature, distorted nature, created things that are harmful to the nature, that are as a result of that, we experience so many natural disasters. You know, the earthquakes, the floods, and fires are all somewhat a result of man abuse of nature and how he has contaminated this nature. And as a result, we see this. And as I said, aftermath, after the floods, after the earthquakes, can you see aftermath is more painful and deadly than the act itself, because dead bodies all around, they breed back, attract bacteria, and it causes different kinds of disease, all because of man's irresponsibility over the nature that God has given him to enjoy. So to a great extent, that is what is man can be held responsible. Now the question, his intentions may be right. He may be right in, you know, doing things, not understanding that the effects could be bad later. For example, medicine. No, man makes medicine. The intention is good to bring healing when we get sick. But we also know that medicines have side effects. While it is trying to cure a problem that is on the surface, it is also creating something else. Sometimes some of the medicines have more side effects than the healing itself, like a chemotherapy. Sometimes many people are not able to come out because not only it is destroying the bad cells, it has the power to destroy the good cells. So while the intentions may be right to do what we are doing, we must also understand the side effects or the other things are also damaging human life. For example, some years ago, asbestos was a good thing. Everybody had houses built with asbestos roofs and other things. But you know, for the last 20, 25 years, they realized asbestos is one of the major causes for cancer. It's causing cancer and some other lung diseases, because when you breathe in, it is affecting. So while we make certain things to be useful to our life as humans, in that process, unintentionally, we're also creating a situation where they become the cause of death and sickness to the very humans that have created it. So man, directly or indirectly, has a relation to the things that we are experiencing right now. So what about virus? Can man create virus? Virus is something that we are not able to see with our naked eye. Can he create? They say virus is a very tiny infectious agent that produces inside the cells of living hosts. When infected, the host cell is forced to rapidly produce thousands of identical copies of the original virus. So does man have the power to create virus? While the intention of creating virus, yes, man can create virus. Why? Because the intention is to fight the infection. While the intention is to create the virus, there are dangers of man's negligence in handling the virus, which could prove dangerous and life-threatening. For example, the Atlantic.com, one of these scientific journal article, there's an article which came in 2014, May 20, where it says, scientists are creating new incurable diseases in lab. Incurable diseases are being created in lab. This says, for example, swine flu or H1N1 had been dead for 20 years when it suddenly re-emerged in 1977 with a curious twist. This new strain was genetically like one from the 1950s, almost as thought it had been. Why? Because it has been sitting frozen in the lab since then. Indeed, it eventually became clear that the late 70s flu outbreak was likely the result of a lowly lab worker who was confused and chaotic. He messed it up. As a result, it bred again. It says lab accidents are extremely rare, but they still happen. Two scientists are now arguing that it's not worth continuing to create new transmissible versions of deadly viruses in labs. Why? Because the risk that these diseases will escape and infect the public is too great. The H5N1 avian flu killed 24 people in Hong Kong in 1997. It has only killed about 400 people worldwide since then, though because it doesn't pass easily from human to human. In recent years, scientists have found a way to make H1N1 jump between ferrets, the best animal model for flu viruses in humans. Look at the kind of experiments that they are creating with this virus that they have created. They say they need to create a transmissible version in order to better understand the disease and to prepare potential vaccines. That worries people like Mark Lipsit and Allison, two epidemiologists who writes in a medical magazine editorial, saying that creating these types of infectious agents puts human life at risk. They estimate that if 10 American laboratories run these types of experiments for a decade, there would be a 20% chance that a lab worker would become infected with one of these new superfluous and potentially pass it on to others. The concern is that you're making something that doesn't exist in nature and combines high virulence for people with the ability to transmit efficiently, he told. Accidents involving lab-grown pathogens aren't just the stuff of scientific movies. It is said that a Singaporean lab worker was inadvertently infected with SARS in 2003, and in 2004, a Russian scientist died after accidentally sticking herself with a needle contaminated with Ebola at a Siberian lab. In April, Paris Pasteur Institute lost 2,000 vials containing the SARS virus, which causes bleeding under the skin, in internal organs, or from body like the mouth, eyes, or ears. The medical world seems perpetually torn between the desire to eliminate horrific diseases entirely and the need to preserve them for future study. Thanks to vaccination, smallpox was eradicated in 1980, but there are still two samples of it living in labs, one in the US and one in Russia. Sometimes some scientists argue that those vials should be destroyed because there's a chance they could be used as a bioterrorism. There is no cure for smallpox, and it kills a third of its victims. The rest suffer permanent scarring from the thousands of pox or fluid-filled cysts. So though we have overcome, we are still holding on to them. Who knows if somebody someday decides to leave it out, spread it out, what could it do to the human life? So the hazard is, could it ever by accident or by evil design leave those two containments and actually be introduced into the population again and they could be spread? William Schaffner, chair of the preventive medicine at Vanderbilt University in Nashville, told ABC News, the World Health Organization is deciding that they should be, if they can destroy these vials. Most labs have near bulletproof safety standards, with workers wearing plastic hoods and working behind heavy steel doors. Still, leaks can happen because of failures in respiratory equipment. So Lipsit said, if a worker accidentally touches their eyes or nose with a contaminated glove, it could spread around. We have data from past experience, various labs, that human infections in those labs are not a common event. But with enough labs working for enough years, it's been observed over and over again that Marburg and Ebola viruses have both infected lab workers at a higher level of contaminated than these H5N1. So he also added that past lab accidents haven't resulted in worldwide spread, partly because the virus weren't as contagious as those we have now. In the case of Ebola and Marburg, they aren't that readily transmissible, he said. In the case of SARS, which has been involved in at least three separate lab accidents, there was onward transmission in one case, but it was contained, so we got lucky. So he suggests that rather than breed the new mammal transmissible viruses, scientists use just pieces of the H1N1 strain for their research or work on ancestors of the virus. The scientists conducted the ferret-based H1N1 experiments, went through a year-long voluntary moratorium after a controversy over the study's safety that flayed in 2011. In January 2013, they declared that the experiments would resume because the lab conditions for the experiments met the necessary safety checks. Now, whatever this is, the point I'm trying to make is humans, with the good intention of trying to create a virus to cure the infection, there is a possibility they're also becoming a cause of creating some other diseases, whether it is intentional, whether it is happening or not. So man's intention to do good by creating this virus can also be a cause of creating viruses that could damage and bring death to humans. What about intentionally? Do you think man creates viruses intentionally? If you read, and I'm sure if you're following the news today, so many believe man actually does create some viruses intentionally with the purpose of eliminating certain type of population, certain type of things for his own thing. Now, so intentionally or intentionally, while the lab accidents happen, man is also making certain things intentionally, they say. In creating this virus intentionally, man wants to have riches and power for his own selfish gains. That's what some people say. For example, let us take COVID-19. There are so many theories going around right now how it came about, who created it. One of the example I read and watched on TV and the news is America, there's an organization called Freedom Watch USA or Judicial Watch. The founder is American lawyer Larry Klayman. He filed a case in Texas court for US dollars 20 trillion, the lawsuit against China, because he said they actually created this virus and released it. And so far, if you see today's statistics, we are almost near to 600,000 people affected, 28,000 people already dead. So it is spreading like a wildfire. So he says China has actually did it deliberately. He said that China has violated US laws, international laws, treaties, and norms. He says this COVID-19 is extremely dangerous because it has an extremely aggressive nature. It was designed to mutate from person to person, spreads very quickly and easily. No vaccine exists yet on account of being a new disease. That means the transmission, it takes sometimes, he, according to him, it could take a year or so for a vaccine to literally come to the market. So that's what he filed in his lawsuit for $20 trillion. He said that China did it because they treat it as what? A biological weapon created by China. We spoke about weapons of mass destruction in the past and other things, atomic bombs. But man also has the power. He, you know, biological weapons which are not seen by naked eyes can also cause so much of damage. So he says this is a biological weapon created by China, and they threw it into the world to bring down its economy. He says their purpose is to take revenge on USA and any other country that rises against it. Another reason for China to do it is to destroy the economy of the world and rise itself as the world's superpower. They say China was able to control the virus, but it has spread to almost 180 countries today. If this is not their intention, why would they not have alerted the world as soon as it came? I believe it came in November last year, but the Chinese have never brought it to light. They kept it secret. So he says they have done it intentionally. In his lawsuit, he also mentions that China has actually created, look at this, 1,700 virus strings secretly. And he believes that they will use them as and when necessary for their own advantage. Wuhan, the city where actually we believe this virus has come from, he says, is a center for biological research. And it maintained top secrecy even when it first appeared. They believe that China has already invented vaccination, and that's why they're able to control it completely. He also says some of the biggest companies, the foreign companies, exist in Wuhan. Most of the businesses are controlled by these foreign investors. So the local government or the local businesses are not able to do much. So he says it is one of the weapons that they have used to chase away these foreign big companies so that they could get hold of this business for themselves. Now, by international laws, they have no right to chase anything because they are governed by and protected by the international laws. So he believes that this is the best media that they could use to create fear so that they would leave. In fact, he claims that when this news broke out in Wuhan about this virus, most of the foreign investors sold their business to the local people, to the local businesses, and ran and left the place. And in fact, he says, in 2 days after the news broke, while the whole world economy was not sure how it is going to go, in Wuhan alone, $1.5 trillion profit was made because most of the foreign investors left and the local government and businesses were able to do it. And he also says, we all know that China is a communist country. They have strict laws on how the media or, you know, internet and social media used. News doesn't come out so easily. He also believes that they have even controlled health professionals from not spreading this news. And of course, when this lawsuit was filed, what do you think was the response from China? China said, we took strict actions, regulations. That's why we were able to control this. How can you blame us? Our own people died, they said. And they said, America is jealous about us. They can't control. That's why they're blaming us and putting everything on us. You know, and so why do we create something that kills our own people? That was their response. We do not know what the truth is. Well, we don't know how true the information is, but the fact remains that man has the power to create viruses that can destroy human lives. Another story is going around about this thing is, there's another organization called Act for America. Have you read it? Or just maybe see it. It says, they said China lied and they must be held accountable. They are working so hard to make sure that this is the work of China and they must be held accountable because they have infected almost 180 countries and people are dying. So that's what they believe. They knew it in November 17 last year, but they never revealed the truth. So which means they did it intentionally. And recently there is a WhatsApp audio message that's going around. One of our church member also sent it to me. It's an African pastor, a self-claimed prophet, Jonathan. He says that this COVID-19 is not created by China or as from animals or whatever they're saying. It is actually the result of 5G technology. Well, I'm not a scientific person to get into all those things, but he says it is through these radiations that come through this 5G technology that human lives are being affected. Man is intentionally doing this for his own advantage of making money and making business, and they're not worried about human lives. They don't mind some people being killed for the business to prosper and their desires and goals to be achieved. That's how selfish man is. That's what he says. I'm not sure how true that is, but that is. And in the pharmaceutical world and companies, we know that, you know, one of the biggest making companies is pharmaceuticals. And some stories all around go say that they actually create a disease first and then they create medicine. That's one way to keep these companies, and then one way to keep it flowing and making money so that people live under fear of death and buy things. Well, could be possible, I'm not sure. As I said, I'm not a scientist, neither am I an expert in technology to establish whether what all I shared now are true or false. But one thing I'm so certain, the point of me taking such a long time to make this clear is that man does have the power to create disasters, to create virus. Maybe intention good, but that could be a fatal thing for. So the question, can man do it? Yes. Did he do it? I'm not sure. We'll wait and see. The fourth entity is animals. Are animals responsible for COVID-19? What do you think is the answer? Well, most of us know that the SARS viruses and most of the coronaviruses and their fam, most believe that they actually come from animals. In this case, they believe it came from bats or the seafood that was sold at Wuhan wet market. So animals do carry viruses that can infect human lives and cause death. So scientists have discovered that in most of the coronaviruses, the transmission was through the animals. And in fact, they say about this Wuhan wet market, most of the animals that about all, they eat all sorts of animals. You know, most of them are illegally traded animals. They were not tested for anything. They just buy and they sell them live. So chances of transmitting diseases that they might have is so much there. So can it pass through animals, and can animals carry them? Yes. The last thing is nature, the fifth one. Can nature be the cause of these natural disasters, plagues and pestilences? Yes, the answer is yes. When God created nature, God said it is good. He has given it for man to take care of it well. What did man do by sin? Then whole nature got affected. In fact, Romans 8:22 says, we know that the whole creation has been groaning, as in the pains of childbirth, right from the present, right up to the present time. In other words, the sin not only affected human life, it has affected the nature. The nature reacted in so many ways that God never intended. In fact, Ellen White says in the book Story of Redemption, because when Adam saw the leaves fall for the first time, he realized it was the result of his sin. All his life before sin, he never saw a leaf fall down. But when he sinned, he saw the leaves falling down. Even the nature was affected by the sin that came about. And the way we treat nature nowadays, as I said, how man is abusing nature and by creating things that are harmful to nature to make his life easy and pleasurable, we are actually causing nature to react in such a way that nature is causing so much damage in so many ways. For our selfish reasons, we have abused the nature. For example, this body is created to eat certain foods so that it will stay strong and healthy. When we take certain type of foods that are harmful to the body, how does the body react? For example, take poison, or if your food has been poisoned, food poisoning, what is one of the signs of food poisoning? Uneasiness, headache, and vomitings. That's how the body is reacting to something that is put in it which is not supposed to be. So also, nature's reaction to certain things that we do to abuse it, the reaction to that is natural disasters, the floods, the plagues, or the earthquakes, because we have been not good stewards of taking care of it. So it is possible that nature also has an element of bringing out all these kinds of dangerous things that are harmful to human life. Now, I'm sharing all these things so that we will be fair to say whether it is God, or consider certain reasons as to blame, whether to blame God or not to blame God. While I want you to know, I said five: God, Satan, man, animals, and nature. And one of the things that I believe I try to establish is all five of them have power to bring these natural disasters in one way or the other. But two of them are completely independent on their own, and it doesn't affect them. And that is God and Satan. So far, Satan is not affected by any plague or disease or any natural disaster. Neither can this affect God. But the three things that always get affected and they're intertwined is who? Man, animals, and nature. Whatever happens to one, the other gets affected. So in this case, we realize that these three are the ones that could also be affected. Now, to understand whether this, who really is the responsible, though we can't completely, concretely establish authoritatively, but seeing that every five of them have the power to do it, how do we come to certain conclusions? For example, as I said, animals and nature, you can't blame them on their own because they can't create on their own. What happens in them, in animals or in creation, is a direct result of man's abuse of nature. So now we are left with three: God and Satan and man. Now, out of these three, how do they react when such things comes? Will give us the character of those people to how it becomes. When you think of God, who do you think is more loving out of these three? God, Satan, and man. Who do you think is more loving, more willing to help, more concerned about human life, more willing to take risk to save life? If you say God, yes, how much does God love this world? The scripture says he loves it so much that he gave his only begotten son. So it is never the intention of God to destroy human lives or to bring diseases. It is not his primary intention at all, though he has got the power to do it. The way God responds to natural disasters is to love and to save them. What about devil or Satan? How do you think the devil will react to this phenomena that we are experiencing now? All of us who know the character of the devil, what do we realize? His only work is to steal, the scripture says, to destroy, and to cause havoc in human life. The scripture says he is like a roaring lion. For what? To devour whomever he can. So his only purpose of existence is to kill and to destroy human life. That's what he is all up to. While God is in the business of saving lives, the devil is busy destroying God's children's lives. What about man? Man is so selfish that he too can go to any extent to save his own skin and his own life. In this crisis time, can you see? In few days, the shelves in the shop, supermarkets are emptied, especially the toiletries and the basic things. One man carrying too much for himself. He's not worried that there's so many others who may be in need that he should share with them. No, it is about my survival. It is about my need. So when crises come, man's immediate reaction is to think about himself, not of somebody else. So few of the people are holding most of the necessities. And for example, for the last few days, I've been looking for one item. I still couldn't find it. I've gone to so many shops and I wonder where all those things are. So these three, this is how they react when the natural disaster or virus come. God reacts by showing love. Devil's reaction is to destroy completely. Man's reaction is to save his own skin. and doesn't matter even if it affects somebody else or what. This is how these three people might react. One of the weaknesses of man is that he will seldom accept responsibility for his actions. He is always looking for an excuse or reason to blame anything and everything apart from himself. That's how we react. When something goes wrong, we always have an excuse or something or somebody to be blamed. We seldom take responsibility to say that this is what we have done and we are suffering. The only person who has power over every disease, every natural disaster, including the virus that we are going through, is who? God. He's got power. He's got the ultimate power to stop it, to eradicate it, and get rid of it completely. But so many questions go around this. If God did not send this virus, at least he could have stopped it. Is he not a loving God who cares for his creation? How can he keep quiet when there is so much of pain and death everywhere, especially the innocent die? Why can't he do something about it? How many people ask this question? Is it a genuine question? You know, we have distorted the picture of God. We have pictured God in the way we want to see him. Our preachers and churches have turned God into a nice God who loves us in spite of what we do, gives us all that we ask, protects us in spite of our wanderings, does not judge us in spite of our crimes, and saves us no matter what we do. What a distorted picture of God. Prosperity gospel teaches all this. God who heals and saves and gives you rich and makes you rich. Preaching of the nice gospel is number one reason for the collapse of Christianity in the Western world. Let me repeat it again. These are not my words, one of the authors said. Preaching of the nice gospel is number one reason for collapse of Christianity in the global North and West. From Genesis to Revelation, you will not find a nice and a sweet God anywhere. The good news that we preach is not nice after all the time. And it isn't nice to many people, but it is the truth that we are called to preach. So we only look at God wanting to be a nice God. We expect God because we have a picture of him. He's the one who is going to sort out my problem. He's the one who's going to give me money. He's the one who's going to heal me. Everything about that. But what about the others? Every coin we say has two sides. What about the other side of God? While he is loving and caring and kind and healing, is that all God all about? Or does he have another side that we so purely, so solely neglect it? What about the other side? Where is the God of justice? Where is the God of judgment? Where is the God of vengeance? We don't like these words, justice, judgment, vengeance. We don't even want to attribute these things to God because we have pictured him as only loving and caring. He should be like my coach, teaching me, telling me, giving me, doing everything for me. He's like my genie. Whatever I ask, he has to give me. That's the picture we have developed. Now that's why when we think of these words like God of justice, God of judgment, God of vengeance, it doesn't make a sense to this. God can be that way. But scripture says that God is not only God of mercy, but he's a God of justice. He cannot show mercy at the expense of justice, because the scripture says justice and mercy must meet together. If he has to show mercy at the expense of justice, there's no need for God to come down to this earth, live that painful life and die on the cross. Because he has to meet the justice, he cannot undo it. Because he is a God who doesn't change, he has to meet the criteria. So God is not only God of justice, and God is not only a God of mercy, he is a God of justice as well. You know, sometimes every time we mess up, we expect God to clean it up for us. And when he doesn't show up the way we expect him, we blame him for the mess in the first place. When are we going to learn to clean up our own mess and stop blaming God for everything that's happening? When are we going to take responsibility for the things that is happening to us? But the question is, even though God is not responsible, can God use our mess up, our mess up for his own advantage? Yes, sometimes he doesn't interfere immediately because he can use our mess up to his own advantage. God can use every situation on this earth for his own advantage. God will allow the disease and other afflictions to affect mankind. I'm telling you, not that he sent it, he will allow that which is coming to affect mankind to precisely the degree needed to help them repent and turn back. It is an opportunity for us to see the reality and turn back to him. Whether it is Satan sent or man sent or God sent, we do not know. But God can use this situation to open the eyes of his people. He uses these situations to accomplish his purposes and his will. Can God use these situations to steer humanity back to himself? Yes. Certain lessons we will never learn. Get this, please. Certain lessons we will never learn in peace and prosperity. The only way to learn is in hard times. Even then, some of us do not learn. You know, some people say, oh, these are God's judgments. Some of the conservative preachers, some of those who connect everything to God are saying, these are God's judgments. No, but the question is God's judgments necessary? Is it justifiable? Even if this were to be the judgment of God in whatever form it has taken, is it justifiable? What do you think is the answer? Can God send judgments on this earth and justify? Yes, of course, he can. Even if it is God's judgments, it is justifiable for two reasons. Why? Number one, because God's mercies and his faithfulness and his long-suffering and his patience with humans is not changing humans. How long he has been patient with us, instead of us being blessed by that patience and coming closer to him, we are actually going far from him. So when goodness and mercy and grace is not working out, God can use something else to catch your attention and my attention. So even if this was to be his judgment, it is justifiable, it is necessary, because his mercy and grace seems to take us far away from him because we take it for granted. We take it for granted. We are filled with covetousness, evil doing. We have, you know, desecrated the law of God. We have rewritten the laws of marriage to suit our own evil living. We have kicked away God from our schools, our homes, our workplaces, because we want to live the way we want. God's mercy should have changed us, but instead it is not helping us because we are blinded by our own selfish lifestyles. So if God were to send his judgment, he is justifiable because he has done all that he could to turn you back, and we still don't listen. The body reacts in that way. When you take everything that it's supposed not to be taken, it reacts in the form of sickness and disease. Okay, we protect the vilest things on this earth under the name of free speech. Abuse of girls and women. When what God called holy, we abuse it. We make sin entertaining. That's what is the movies all about, entertaining. Sin seems to be so nice and entertaining. The language in the movies is so common. We use that language more than the normal good language that some people have to use. And here we are asking God for a blessing. We do all that we do. We continue to do all that we have to do. And yet when something goes wrong, that's when even we as Christians turn to God and say, Lord, have mercy. And the mercy that we are asking is what? Not a change of a heart, but a blessing. Help, Lord, that this coronavirus will not affect me. Help, Lord, that my children will be safe. Help, Lord, my job I will not lose. Help, Lord, that it will not go to this extent. It is all again a selfish reason for prayers that we are calling upon. God's judgments are needed because God uses his judgments as a revival. Here we are asking God to blessing for the mess that we made. We are not asking him to clean up the mess we made, but we are asking him to bless us in spite of the mess that we are in. And that is not a good way of looking at it. We are stewards of this world, and when we abuse our stewardship, someone has to clean it up. Maybe everyone would like to keep their garden clean. How do you feel if you own a nice garden which you kept it clean and a neighbor or an enemy comes and throws things at it and makes it dirty? How do you feel about it? You don't like it. How long will you tolerate it? That's what we have been doing to this God's creation, God's earth. God wants it to be clean. God wants it for his purposes. But we have been messing it day in and day out. How long? God has to use a media sometimes to clean up the mess. Like how you do it in your own garden to keep it clean. The world is God's property. And he has power. Because he created it, he has power to do anything he can to keep it clean, to make it good. God is gracious in giving all our needs. Someone wrote this. I like this. God is gracious in giving all our needs and pleasing us while we continue to displease him by living our own selfish and abusing his creation. You know, by abusing his creation and his love, you know what we are abusing? We are abusing God's goodness and his long-suffering. This we see in our families. Sometimes when we are so kind to people, so long-suffering and patient, they actually take advantage of our good news and goodness, and they abuse our goodness. And the same thing we are doing. So even if this were to be the judgments of God, it is necessary. What about not only God's judgments are necessary? God's judgments are sometimes actually the answer to our prayers. Answer to our prayers. God's people have been crying from ages past to him. What was their cry? Lord, come soon. We are tired of staying here. We are tired of living here. We have been praying, Lord, let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We are praying that we want God to come. We are praying that God's will be done. How can God come? How can God's will be done if he doesn't accomplish his purposes of cleaning up this place? He can't come unless he accomplishes. So maybe because we are crying and praying, this could be. You know, every sincere prayer, unselfish prayer must have three things. What is it? Hallowed be thy name. In everything that happens, our prayer must say, Lord, may your name be glorified. The second is, thy kingdom come. This is what God taught us. Everything that he does, it is for his kingdom to come. Whether it is good or bad, he does it. He allows it for his kingdom to come. And finally, thy will be done. Our prayer must not be what you want it to be done. Our prayers must be that his will be done. So, to bring nations on its knees and to bring man to the end of himself, God can use sickness, recession, drought, floods, and even COVID-19. Look at now how many people are looking back to God. You know, I'm not saying this is sent by God. I don't believe he is the one who sent it, but he can use this situation to turn people back to him. Someone said, God whispers to us in our pleasure. When we can't hear him much. But God shouts to us in our pain. He said, suffering is God's megaphone to wake up the dead world. We need that. Sufferings are God's surgical tools to improve the spiritual health of his people. So, what is the solution then? Whether it is God sent, Satan sent, or man has made, you make your own conclusions. I'm clear in my mind what it is, but I want you to make your own mind. Where it come from? How did it come? Who is responsible? So, but right now, whether it is God sent or man made or Satan sent is immaterial, unimportant. Why? Because it is here now. The only thing that matters now is, how can I get rid of it? How can I overcome it? How can we eradicate it? That should be the question, rather than debating and arguing and blaming each other. So if you were to answer that, where does the real help come from then? As I said, Satan will not help you because his only intention is to destroy. Man has no help. Man has no power because man is so selfish. All that he does is, whether the intentions are good or bad, it is to destroy his own life, sometimes to save his own skin, which is actually not helping. See, the only source of help in this time is God. Only God can arrest and eradicate COVID-19. I will close with a beautiful story in the scripture that reminds how God can change things and blesses no matter who has brought this into our lives. Let's turn to 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel chapter 24. 2 Samuel chapter 24. Here is a beautiful story about a plague that the children of Israelites experienced. Here is a story where David asks his army men to go and count the number or take census of his army. His army general Joab says, King, it's not a good idea. Why do you have to think? You are a powerful man. You have a great army. If you need, God can send even more. You don't have to count this. But you know, king's word is final, the Bible says. So those men and go and count the army, take census. They took 9 months and 20 days. I'm in 2 Samuel chapter 24, verse 8. How long did they take? 9 months and 20 days. And by then they came with the conclusion, verse 9. They said, in Israel they have 800,000 Israelites who can fight. And in Judah they had 500,000. And when David, he did it, in spite of his advisors telling, it's not a good idea. Not only it displeased his army generals, it displeased God. It showed that he is depending on his army for his livelihood, for his protection, rather than the God who is the his protection. So verse 10 says, and David's heart condemned him. He felt sorry for what he had done. And he had numbered the people. Then he said, I have sinned greatly. I have sinned, but now I pray, Lord, take away the iniquity of your servant, for I have done very foolishly. Now he says, Lord, have mercy. But you know what? He already did a damage. Look how God responds. And when David rose in the morning, the word of the Lord came to him. I'm reading verse 11 from the prophet Gad. David says, saying, go and tell David, thus says the Lord, I offer you three things. Choose one of them for yourself, that I may do it for you. He says, okay, because you sinned, punishment is there. But you choose what type of punishment you want. Three things. What is the first thing? Verse 13. So Gad came to David and told him, and he said to him, shall 7 years of famine come to you in your land? That's number one. Do you want 7 years of famine in your land? Number two, or you will flee 3 months before your enemies. Do you want to be chased by your enemies for the next 3 months? Or the last thing is what? I will send a plague for 3 days. Now you decide what you want. This is the punishment for the sin that you committed. Look at verse 14. And David said to Gad the prophet, I am in great distress. Please, let us fall into the hand of the Lord, for his mercies are great, but do not let me fall in the hand of man. This is the solution that I want to suggest. What did he say? Do you want 7 years famine? Do you want to be chased by your enemies for 3 months? Or do you want me to send plague for 3 days? What do you think? You know, David was a wise man. He decided, it is better for me to fall in the hands of God than in the hands of man. He did not choose 7 years of famine, which could have definitely wiped away his whole nation. He didn't choose to be chased away by his enemies for 3 months, because why? That could have completely wiped away his kingdom. He decided, I would rather fall for mercies of God than to fall in the hands of men. So as we go through this COVID-19, as I said, if you have to give yourself to devil, he'll completely destroy you. If you were to depend on the arm of men, he himself will destroy you. The only safety we have in this time of crisis is, like David, we should say, "For let me fall into the hand of God." Why? For his mercies are great. In spite of pain and loss and death that we are seeing around, his mercies are great. So he decided he would take the punishment from God. So what happened then? Verse 15. So the Lord sent what? A plague upon Israel from the morning till the appointed time. That means for 3 days. You know how many people it killed? The Bible says, from Dan to Beersheba, 70,000 men, not one, two, 70,000 men died. And the next verse says, angel stretched his hand over Jerusalem. Finally, he has come to Jerusalem, and then it stopped. Why did the angel stop? You know what he did? The prophet comes to David and says, you have to offer a sacrifice. Build an altar to the Lord and offer a sacrifice if this plague have to go away. So what did he do? He quickly, and he also tells him where to offer the sacrifice. In the interest of time, you read it later. There's a person called Arona, a Jebusite. And so he says, you have to go to his threshing floor, and that's where you have to do it. He goes to Arona and says, look, I have to use your threshing floor to build an altar to the Lord and offer a sacrifice. Arona says, oh king, you can take it. Not only you take my threshing floor, you can take the animals that you want. I'll give it for free. Look at what David says in verse 24. Verse 24, then the king said to Arona, no, but I will surely buy it from you for a price. Nor will I offer burnt offerings to the Lord my God with that which costs me nothing. What did David say? I will not give anything to the Lord that doesn't cost me anything. What a beautiful lesson to learn. Sometimes we need to understand that when you give something to the Lord, has it costed you something? Sometimes we throw pennies to God, that which we think we can manage. But here, psalmist is saying, David is saying, I will give that which costs. So finally, what does he do? He buys it. Verse 25. Then David built an altar to the Lord and offered burnt offerings and peace offerings. Look what the next part of the verse says. So the Lord heeded his prayers for the land, and the plague was withdrawn from Israel. So what happened? The only way God withdrew is when David repented, built an altar, offered sacrifices unto the Lord. We have a solution for COVID-19 right here. Instead of blaming how it came, who brought it, and trying to find all the scientific and human reasoning, because it is here and it is real, there's only one solution, that is, fall at the mercies of God. And when you fall at your mercies, confess your sins. What did David do? He built an altar to the Lord. You must build an altar to the Lord in your heart, in your homes. Confess your sins. Offer yourself as a living sacrifice. And when David did it, the plague was lifted. And when you and I do it, God will lift this plague up. I am very positive. It will pass away. But while it is there, it will test your faith. It will test my faith, where we put our trust. I pray that as we close today, that your trust will be on Jesus, the rock of ages. Now the scripture says, 1,000 may fall at your side and 10,000 at your right hand. Nothing will come to you, because God is your refuge and your strength. Trust him, give him your life completely, offer yourself as a living sacrifice, build an altar to him, be his child, and you will come through this successfully, so that we can come back someday soon and praise God and testify of his goodness. God bless each one of us. Let us pray. Gracious Father, thank you for your word. Lord, while the whole world is looking at whom to blame, who should be held responsible, and as so many people blame you, every time there is a bad thing happening in the world, it is God to be blamed. When good happens, you will be forgotten. Lord, it is here. How it came is immaterial, because it is already here. How we fight it is what we need to do. Your word has given us a solution. When the plague came, David decided the best way to fight it is to fall at the feet of Jesus and seek his mercies, because you are gracious and merciful and abundant in grace. He did it. He built an altar. He offered sacrifices. He confessed his sins. And your word says, you lifted up the plague and there was peace in the land. Lord, I pray that I and all those who are watching and all your children will fall at the feet of Jesus. Seek his mercies, because only you have the power to take it away. The devil can't, because his only intention is to kill. Man will struggle to do it because his intentions are so selfish. But your intentions are good. You are here to save us. You have even given your life so that we could live. So we plead for your mercies, Lord, that as we offer ourselves as a living sacrifice and as we confess our sins, you forgive us. Keep us away from this virus, that it will not affect us. But at the same time, may these trying times open our eyes to see that we need to worry more about our spiritual lives than our physical lives, so that, Lord, no matter what happens, we are safe in your arms. May this be our experience as we go through this crisis. In Jesus' name, amen.